13 years ago now at Willamette. This is the 14th time that I've had the privilege of hearing him, and I'm so happy to see so many people here who get to hear him as well. When I first heard Mr. Weiner, I remember expecting that maybe the message would be really depressing, right, considering the subject matter. And my first impression was just how inspiring, what an inspirational story, and how uplifting this man is. I remember that I quickly discovered that his real message was not in what he had lived through, but how he had lived through what he went through. For me and the many thousands of people whom he has touched with his message, he is a hero. A hero who wakes up every day and chooses love and forgiveness over hatred. There is an old Navajo chant that says, "Remember what you have seen, because what is forgotten returns to the wind." There are fewer than 30 Holocaust survivors in the state of Oregon today. This morning we have an incredible, incredible opportunity. An opportunity to hear from Mr. Weiner, who remembers what he has seen and lived through, and he asks you to do the same. Al wanted me to tell you today that it is his 884th speaking engagement. So he tells me that the alternative to speaking every day is not lovely, so he just wants to keep going until his last breathing moment. And then finally, I wanted to conclude by asking you to be as respectful as possible and as silent as possible, to absolutely turn off your phones, put them away, okay, all the way off. Take a moment, please, and do that now if you have not. And with that, I present to you Mr. Al Weiner.
Good morning, and thank you for being here, willing to listen to my life story. It's a very sad story, but it's a very true story. I have no reason to exaggerate or to tell you something which did not happen. I know it's hard to believe my own children have difficulties to believe. But I came to Oregon the year 2000, and I was asked by the Oregon Holocaust Resource Center to share my story. I was very hesitant, I had an accent, my English is not perfect, but I gave it a chance, and my first presentation was at Century High School in Hillsboro. A week later, the teacher gave me letters from those students, about 100 letters. What did they write to me? "Mr. Weiner, you changed my life. You saved my life. You made me appreciate my country. Maybe I appreciate my school, my parents, and so on and on." Then I realized that I'm doing something important. And that is the main reason that I am making an effort. It's not easy. I'm 88 years old. It is not easy emotionally. When I talk about it, I see images. But getting the feedback, I received 57,000 letters so far. And if you read those letters, you'll realize the impact, the positive impact that sharing my story has on those who hear me or who read my book. Why did I write my book? I had no intention to write a book. I don't feel qualified to write a book. But I went to one of the churches in Vancouver, Washington State. At the end of my presentation, an older man approached me with tears in his eyes, and that is what he told me. "Mr. Weiner, I was an officer in the American Army in 1945. I'm one of the liberators of Buchenwald, which is a very infamous camp in Germany. I remember what we found in those liberated camps. I have nightmares till this very day. Please promise me in front of the church if you are going to put your life story in print, do it for my children and for my grandchildren." So that's the only reason that I wrote the book. I have no financial interest in it. But apparently, it is a good book. If you go to Amazon.com, you'll see that there are 46 million books, and my book this morning was rated number 59. So obviously, it is a good book. And if you read my book, you'll see on page 158 a handwritten letter and an eighth grader, that she intended to kill herself on Thursday, whatever the problem was. But when she heard my story, she realized that her problems are so trivial that she did not kill herself. She realized that her problems at the age of 14, in comparison to the problems at my age, when I was 14, and you all can relate to my story very well, because it happened to me when I was about your age. You see over there in my book, a handwritten letter by another student, that her mother passed away on ovarian cancer right here in Portland. And she was very close to her mother. When her mother died, she had suicidal thoughts. But when she heard my story, that I lost 123 members of my extended family, my grandparents, uncles, aunts, cousins, they were all murdered. I'm the only survivor of my immediate family. Then she said to herself, all right, I'm still back. I have a daddy. I have grandparents. You, Mr. Wiener, at my age, lost everybody. So you get a complete different perspective, and you start to appreciate your situation. And appreciation is so important. You know, Plato said 2,400 years ago, an appreciated mind is a great mind. So as I gave you one reason. The second reason that I'm making an effort to share my story was there are people who know very little about Holocaust. The other day, a teacher asked me to make him a copy of how I looked after the war. So I went to Kinko's to make a copy. But I didn't know how to operate the copy machine. I asked the young man to help me. And he looked at the picture, looked at me, and he said, is this you? Yes. You don't look like a criminal, he said. I'm not a criminal. I'm a Holocaust survivor. He had no idea what I was talking about. I was shocked. And he was brought up right here in Portland. The third reason is that I'm making an effort to share my story is because there are people who deny all of it. They say it didn't happen. There's no other event in history that has been so well documented as World War II, including the Holocaust, mainly because of the advent of photography and recording. Somebody says it didn't happen. There are 17,000 books about Holocaust. There are 27 Holocaust museums just in the United States. There are Holocaust museums which exhibit all over the world. Still, there are people who say it didn't happen. When my book came out, the first copy, I went to the post office and sent it to the president of Iran, Ahmadinejad. Because he, in the United Nations, said a few years ago that the Holocaust is an it. How dare he say so? There are still Holocaust survivors, not many, who carry their physical and mental scars, and somebody tells you it did not happen. That is so painful. And since I sent him my book, as long as he was president, now he's no longer president, I sent him letters and proof that there was a Holocaust. In my most recent letter, I sent him a copy of the check that I had been getting from Germany every month for the last 62 years. And I asked him, if there was no Holocaust, why did the Germans send me a check every month and not to you? I mean, it is ridiculous if somebody comes, he makes a mockery out of himself denying. So I'm giving you the three main reasons why I'm making an effort to share my story. This is me. I know it's hard to believe that this and this is the same person. But that is how I looked soon after the war, when I was liberated in that camp, Waldenburg. In that camp, they used to shave us in the middle of the head to be recognized if somebody contemplated to run away. This is another picture of me when I was 14 years old. A neighbor of mine took that picture. I was not aware of it. I look very despondent here. And she survived the Holocaust and gave me that picture after the war. This is the only picture that I had. You are going to hear me later that at one point the German stripped me naked and they took away from me everything that I had from home. I don't even have a birth certificate to this very day. So this is the only picture of me at the age of 14. Who am I? Where do I come from? I come from a little town called Chrzanów in Poland. Very close to the German border. A town of about 22,000 population, half Jewish and half Roman Catholic. As a little kid, I had a pretty good life. Even though I didn't have any of those conveniences that you take for granted today, I did not have as a child. We didn't have running water, neither could they. We didn't have a refrigerator, a car, an air conditioner, a television. It didn't exist when I was a little kid. But there were certain values instilled in me as a child that the older I get, the more appreciative I am. Just to give you an idea, I had to go to visit my grandparents every weekend to say hi, to show them my respect, my love. They never gave me a toy. Again, it wasn't available, they couldn't afford it, but it was my responsibility to go to see him every weekend, there in Chrzanów. On New Year's Eve, I had to knock at the door 24 times in our building and wish everybody a happy New Year. This was my responsibility. We had a homeless person at our supper table, sometimes two or three, and we were brought up to respect as homeless people. We call them our guests. I went to a public school in the morning and to a religious school in the afternoon 6 days a week. This is the kind of environment and culture that I come from. And all this came to an end on September 3rd, 1939, when the German army invaded Poland. And as you see, my little town is very close to the German border. So people try to get away from the border. How do you get away? Nobody in my little town had a car. I know for an Oregonian, it's difficult to comprehend how the people live without a car. But that's the thing. Nobody had a car. So how do you get away? You take your personal belongings on your back and you walk into the interior of Poland, hoping that somehow the Germans will not succeed to take over the entire country of Poland. Those who could afford, they hired a coachman with a horse-drawn wagon, and they did try to get away. That is what my father did. He could afford it, he hired somebody, and we did try to get away from the border. When I say we, it is my stepfather. My mother died when I was 4 years old. I do not remember her. My older brother, myself, and my younger brother. My father couldn't join us because the Polish retreating army gave him an order, you stay put, because we need the groceries from your business. So he couldn't join us, but we managed to get away about 40 miles to a location called Domowa. When we got there, the janitor died. So basically, we didn't accomplish anything by our attempt to avoid the Germans. The Polish army was no match to the mighty, mighty German forces. And as you know, Poland was occupied within a very short time. But we were stuck over there for 3 months. We couldn't go back home because there were no means of transportation. Eventually, when we did get back home, we found our apartment looted and my father, that we left them behind, wasn't there. Any place that we inquired, nobody knew what happened to Mr. Wiener. Eventually, they came to us from the Judenrat, which was a local committee, and they told my stepmother something which I'll never forget. We know that your husband is missing, but we also know that at the outskirts of our town, there's a pit of victims thrown in by the Germans. If you'd like to know whether your husband is one of the victims, we are going tomorrow morning to open that pit in order to identify those victims. What about to happen? The Germans picked up at random 38 people in our town, mostly Jews, some Christians, and they shot them. They shot them not to be killed instantly, they shot them to bleed, to suffer, until they expired, and then they threw them into a pit, not in a normal fashion, the way you throw in stones. And this happened on September 11th, a very infamous day. But this was September 11th, 1939. So if somebody was murdered on September 11th, and we tried to identify those bodies 3 months later, in November 39, very difficult. If somebody is buried for 3 months, the bodies are partially decomposed. And in those days, we didn't have DNA. So it took a long time. 10 had never been murdered. But my stepmother did recognize my father's body, like the certain items that he had in his clothing that she was familiar with. She collapsed, and for me, at that point, I was 13 years old. You can imagine what kind of traumatic experience it was for me at such tender age. I had nightmares till this very day, even though this happened 70 years ago. And I see images of my father's partially composed face. I was devastated. The following morning, we took those victims. One of them managed to escape during the night, but all the other 37 victims were put into caskets, and we took them to give them a proper burial in our cemetery. And it took a long time to prepare a mass grave, because in those days we didn't have earth-moving machinery that you are used to see today. People volunteered to prepare a mass grave, and it took a long time. And I was standing next to my father's casket as a 13-year-old boy, crying, praying, asking him a simple question. Daddy, why did they kill you? What have you done? I didn't understand it. I didn't understand it at age of 13. And believe you me, that I don't understand it at age of 88 that I'm today. Why did they murder my father? He didn't do anything wrong. I was devastated. I talked to him, where am I going to go? Who's going to take care of me? I was completely lost. Eventually, those victims were buried. This is the monument erected. It's in the Hebrew language, my father, number 23. And this is the official document that I received from the Polish government that my father was murdered on the 11th Rishon, which means September 1939. So obviously, life was very, very difficult. Every day the Germans issued new orders to make our life miserable. But there was no mass murder as it started later on in 1941. But the first order that they gave me, that I couldn't go to school anymore. My formal education ended at the age of 13. I couldn't go to school. I had to bow my head before any passing by German. I could live only in a ghetto. Very restricted area, segregated, so many restrictions. So that's it, I couldn't go to school. I'm not a jealous person, but when I look at you, I envy you that you can go to school when you are young and you have no other responsibilities. Maybe you don't realize how privileged you are, how lucky you are. Would you like to know? When I graduated from high school, I came to New York. I had no skills to make a living. I cleaned some toilets. But I wanted to improve myself, so I went to Brooklyn College. I wanted to learn accounting. So they told me, to be admitted to college, where is your certificate from high school? To be admitted to college, you have to show a certificate from high school. But I didn't finish high school. I didn't even finish elementary school. So they told me, sorry, young man, you cannot be admitted to college. So the only option I had was to work daytime, to make a living, study in the evening, submit a test to New York State, and when I did pass that test, they gave me that piece of paper, which is called equivalency high school diploma, and with that piece of paper, I was admitted to Brooklyn College in the evening. I studied accounting, and I made a living till I retired at the age of 73 as an accountant. But you'll be surprised in those thousands of letters that I received, how many students realize it is easier to graduate at the age of 18 than to graduate at the age of 35 that I'm here. Which reminds me, the other day, I went to buy a pair of sneakers in Hillsborough, and this young lady approached me. She said, may I help you? And I said, yes, please. Then she said, oh my God, I know who you are. You spoke in my school about a year ago. So I said, Uncle Lucas, you recognize me. And she said, you know something? My mother would like to hug you and kiss you. I said, I'm ready. But she said, you don't know why. Yes, why? I'll tell you why, she said, because when you came to my school, this was exactly the time the guy intended to quit school. I was bored at high school. But listening to your story, I realized how lucky, how privileged I am. And I told my mom, I'm going to work in the shoe store part-time and continue my education. Obviously, I'm very gratified if I can make a young person stay in school, because I know from my personal experience how bad, how difficult life is if you don't have an education. So, as I said, there was no mass murder in 1940-41, but in the middle of the night, May 1941, the Germans knocked at the door of our apartment, and they took my older brother away. Once somebody was deported, no contact. He couldn't write, he couldn't call. We had no idea what happened to him. If he was alive, there wasn't. 1 year later, in June 1942, in the middle of the night, the German busted into our apartment. They looked at me. They didn't ask my age. They just told me in the German language, you have a few minutes to get ready. My stepfather pleaded with the German. He's such a young boy. He's 15 years old. Have mercy. Don't take him away from me. I love this boy. What did the Germans do? They slapped on the face. You dare to question our action? And they took me away. I never had a chance to say goodbye to my stepmother and to my younger brother. What did the Germans do with me? They put me into a barn like this. Maybe some of you have seen documentaries like Schindler's List or The Pianist, and you saw this kind of a barn before. But picture yourself, 80 people were pushed into that car. Nothing to eat, nothing to drink for a day and a half. Do you hear me? Nothing to eat, nothing to drink for a day and a half. We were all standing all the time. There was no room where to sit down. One of us did die. He died standing like a pillar. There was no room where to fall. There are no words in the dictionary to describe the hellish condition of that hellish car. After a day and a half, I arrived at my first slave labor camp called Lechner in Germany. Upon arrival, I was beaten for no good reason. But something unexpected happened to me. One of the prisoners in that camp recognized me from my hometown and told me, "Did you know that your brother became him?" I didn't know. So he took me to meet my brother. I did not recognize my own brother. Not seeing him for 1 year, he aged 10 years like an old man. I just didn't recognize him. This is one of the most traumatic experiences in my life, that I couldn't recognize my own father. Why did he deteriorate to such an extent that I didn't recognize him? Just to give you an idea, the condition in those camps. 24 people of different ages were housed in a very small room, 8 by 10. There were 3 bunks or 3 beds, no mattresses, just floor infested with roaches and lice. They gave us 2 slices of bread in the morning, and the bread was made out mostly of sawdust. Sawdust. It won't be edible for any person who has more or less a normal life, but we had no choice. That's all we got. Lunch, we never got lunch. And at the evening, coming back from after a long day of hard work, they gave us a soup, which was very diluted. Lucky you were if you found a floating potato or another vegetable. Obviously, people were undernourished, malnourished, and they constantly dying from starvation. According to my reading, 50 million people, including 4 million Russian prisoners of war, died of starvation. And to die of starvation is a very painful way to die from. Why? Because the body eats itself. I personally experienced starvation and know how painful it is to suffer or to die of starvation. So my brother was very pleased that we are going to be together, but on the other hand, he was very concerned, how will I be able to endure those terrible conditions that he already had experienced for 1 year. At the very first day, Marshall said, "Well, I learned something which is very important. And I can see that you are attentive, listening to me, respectful. I really appreciate it. But I would like you to remember that, what I'm going to tell you now. I had the impression that only me, because I happened to be a Jewish boy, that I was oppressed. But marching to work, I saw so many different groups marching to the same place. Each group had a different badge attached to the garment to identify them. Who were they? Jehovah Witness, homosexual, gypsy, undesirables, POW. Maybe 30, 40 different groups. They all marching to the same place. What did I learn? Every Jew was a victim. But not every victim was a Jew. Please remember that. Every Jew was a victim, but not every victim was a Jew. It is my personal conviction. If Hitler had won the war, you and you wouldn't be sitting here in a free society. Hitler had a plan. Heute Deutschland, morgen wir alle. Today we are in Germany. Tomorrow, we shall be everywhere. You don't have blue eyes and blonde hair. You are not a pure blooded German. I am going to enslave you. And if I feel like I'm going to annihilate you, it is very well documented. This was his plan. So we are all lucky that Hitler did not win the war. What do you see here? This is a German woman. But she had to have her blue eyes and blonde hair. They measured her scalp to be sure that she is pure German race. Does this make sense to you? To determine somebody's ability or character based on the color of the hair, the color of the eye, or the color of the skin? If you have an open mind, if you have an open mind, you will come to the same conclusion that prejudice or stereotyping is absurd. This is a jam. So we are all lucky that Hitler did not win the war. I was at that camp, Lechamer, only for 4 months. In October 1942, the Germans decided to send me to another camp called Brandenburg. By doing so, they separated me from my older brother, and from that moment, I had never seen my brother again. After the war, where he didn't show up, I assumed that he perished, like all the other 123 members of my extended family. But I didn't know where or when. But something very dramatic happened to me in New York City some years ago. There was a gathering of Holocaust survivors, and somebody approached me, and he said to me like this, "You don't know me. I was the bookkeeper in your father's business. I remember you as a little child. I have to tell you something. I, with my own hands, pushed your brother's family into the gas chamber in Auschwitz. This was his job. What the German did, they just turned on Cyclone B gas, and all the others, dirty work had to be done by other children, and he knew my brother from home. So he told me that my older brother perished in Auschwitz." You see, this by itself is a very painful experience for Holocaust survivors. Millions of people never had a funeral. They had no grave. We don't have an anniversary of their demise. It reminds me the other day, a student stands up in Concordia University, and he told me, "Mr. Wiener, I know exactly how you mean, what you mean, because my father drowned here in the state of Oregon, and his body has never been recovered, and my mother is miserable that she cannot visit." That sounds great. So as I mentioned, they sent me to a second camp called Brandon. Very hard work. Very harsh winter. I have two toes till this very day. There's no life in them from frostbite. The commander of that camp was actually sadist. He just enjoyed torturing us. There's a concept in German culture, Schadenfreude. Enjoying yourself, entertaining yourself, watching other people dying, suffering and dying. This is the kind of a person he was. It took me once, and many others, into a cold bathroom in the middle of the night, forcing us to be standing underneath a cold shower for the entire night. If you are standing underneath a cold shower in a cold bathroom for the entire night, you can die. And many of us did die. I was in that camp only for 2 months, but I have to mention something to you which is not in my book, because it happened recently. One day I got a telephone call from Michigan University, and somebody introduced himself as a German professor teaching German literature in Michigan University. And he told me on the phone, "My father was involved in that camp, Brandenburg. I lived with a guilt feeling my entire life. I have been looking for survivors. I found one in Australia and one in Canada. And now when I went to the internet, I see that you wrote a book from a name to a number, and you are mentioning that Camp Brandenburg. So I'm calling you to ask you forgiveness." So I told him right away, "There's nothing for me to forgive you. I have nothing against you. You are not responsible for your father's action or inaction." Anyway, we were on the phone for about 7 hours, and I convinced him that I don't hate him because of what his father did. And this is how I feel in general. I have nothing against the German today's generation. You have to judge each individual on his own action. So, from that camp Rande, the Germans sent me to a third camp called Gross Maslowitz, and the conditions were very similar in all those camps. some kind of shelter, food, being beaten every day. But there's one thing happened to me that came close enough of it, which I would like to share with you. And again, I can see that how attentive you are. I really appreciate that. But this is so interesting. This is so traumatic. Listen carefully, think about it, and when you come home, try to analyze it. I can tell you, in those 50,000 letters that I received so far, there are many references to that episode that I would like to share with you. At one point, I worked in a factory, in a textile factory, together with German workers. Most of the women, because men were drafted to the army. The German workers worked in that part of the factory, operating textile machinery, and we prisoners worked in that part of the factory, dismantling old machines and putting up new machinery for the production of ammunition. And there were signs all over the factory in the German language addressed to the German workers, don't give anything to the prisoners, don't talk to them, don't make even eye contact with them. If you do, you are doomed. One day, when I was sitting there in the dismantling machine, a middle-aged German woman, on the way to the restroom, did make eye contact with me, and she hinted to me with her finger like that. I had no idea what she meant. I was very curious. I had a feeling it must be something important. But I had to watch myself that nobody else should notice me approaching that indicated site. Eventually, I did find the right moment, whatever. I found a sandwich of two slices of white bread with a slice of cheese underneath a box. That German woman repeated that noble act of leaving a sandwich for me every day, for 30 days, as long as I worked at the location. She risked her life for me, not once, but 30 times. Every time when she put a sandwich, she risked her life. That is exactly what all the signs indicated. I have no yardstick to measure to what extent it helped me to survive, because this was only for 30 days out of 1,050 days that I was incarcerated. But the question here is, why did she do it? What motivated her? She heard on the radio and she read in the paper every day that I am an Untermensch, subhuman, and she is a master race. Superior. Why was she willing to risk her life for a young Jewish boy? Not one, 30 times. I don't know. What comes to your mind? Think about it. I'll tell you what comes to my mind. Maybe she had a son at my age and felt sorry for me. Maybe she was a religious person and she tried to abide by the tenet of her faith. You have to help somebody in need. Maybe she wanted to make a point that not all the Jews were so cruel. I don't know. I never knew. But I'm so grateful to that German woman. She is my heroine to the last day of my life. Not just because of giving me sandwiches that might help me to survive. She taught me a very important lesson. And I will tell you why. 3 weeks before that, a German guard, for no good reason, punched me and knocked out many of my teeth. In fact, I have no teeth. He was a German, and she was a German. Both of them were German nationals. But one was wicked, and one was a righteous person. What did I learn? That we are going to find good people and bad people in every group. That prejudice, stereotyping, is absurd. You know, Voltaire, the 18th century French philosopher said, those who can make you believe absurdities can make you commit atrocities. So she taught me a very important lesson, and I'm trying to convey the same lesson that I learned to my audiences, either white audiences or my book. Prejudice and stereotyping is senseless. German woman, this is her life, a young Jewish boy, 30 times. I can just tell you, after the war, as soon as I regained some strength, I went to look for her, to thank her. So I went to that location where this happened in 1942. But I didn't know her name. I didn't know her address. But I went to that location, I went to City Hall, and I pleaded with them, help me to locate a woman in 1943. This is her life for me, 30 times. What's her name? What's her address? They looked at me to be insane. How can you locate anybody if you don't have a name or address? But I just didn't play a role. I just felt it. So indebted to that German woman for her righteous deed. Unfortunately, with all my effort, I could never locate her. From that camp, I was sent to my fourth camp called Klettendorf, also in Germany. This was 1944. At that point, the Germans started to nuke the wall. My job was to dig trenches. One day, digging a trench, I came across a raw potato. A farmer left the potato in the field. I picked up the potato and ate. Raw, dirty, unpeeled. A new arrival from Belgium, observing me eating the raw potato, said to me, how in the world can you eat a raw potato? How in the world can you take all this humiliation? I can't. I just came from Belgium. I had a wife, a child, good business, good parents. I'm not going to take it. And I tried to reason with them. If you would have the experience of 2.5 years camp life the way I had, you'd be lucky to find a raw potato. It tasted better than to eat snow. I used to eat snow to survive. You have no idea what starvation means. You might be hungry once in a while. If you are starving, you'll eat anything that you can put your hands on. I used to be happy to find a peel of a potato in a garbage can. And he really didn't last long. From that camp, I was sent to my fifth camp, this was my last camp, called Waldenburg, also in Germany, a very isolated area. I didn't see a woman or a child for 8 months. I didn't see a flower or a meadow for 8 months. I didn't see my own face for 8 months because there were no mirrors in that camp. When I was liberated the first time, I looked at the mirror and I wondered, who is that person? Picture yourself, you get up in the morning and you don't have a towel or a toothbrush or toothpaste. The most basic things that you are so accustomed to needing to have. I have pens the way you have pens. I couldn't write. There was nothing to write with or to write on. I was not permitted to shake a friendly hand. The most basic human instinct couldn't be exercised. I have ears the way you have ears. I couldn't listen to the sound of music. All I could hear was yelling at me, shouting at me, cursing me every day, and telling me that I am no good. On what basis, I'll never understand. I had eyes the way you have eyes. I couldn't read, there was nothing to read. And since there was nothing to read, and we had no radio, we had no idea what was going on in the world. So on May 9, 1945, we assembled to go to work like any other day, but the Germans that ordinarily escorted us to our working place didn't show up, and we wondered why. We were standing motionless till about 1 o'clock, and then a tank of the Russian army approached our gate, and the officer said, "You are free." At that point, we realized that the Germans lost the war. When the Russian soldiers saw our emaciated bodies, they cried like babies. They broke down. They told us, go out to the city. We are giving you 3 days of freedom. Kill Germans. Take revenge. We know how you feel because we lost 22 million of our own people. I didn't go out to kill. It's nothing greatly. My father's slogan was hate hatred and shun violence. But I had a very, very tough time. I could hardly walk. But the German family who lived in the vicinity of the camp offered me to stay in their house until I recovered. And that is what happened. I did stay in her house for a few weeks. And then I went back to Poland to see if somebody of my family survived. This was the only way to find out. There are no computers in those days. And even the Red Cross couldn't give you reliable information who survived and who did not survive. So I did stay in Poland for a few weeks, and only 4 cousins of mine did survive. And as I mentioned before, 123 members of my extended family, they were all murdered. As you see, this is the way the first picture you saw before, how I looked after the war. My total weight was 80 pounds. 80 pounds. I could embrace my tie with one hand. If you try it on yourself, you'll realize in what condition I was. In fact, the Russian doctors didn't give me hope to live. They told me if I live 2 years, it's going to be enough. The other picture that you see here is I took a few months later. I gained 40 pounds from 80 to 120. Just shows you the difference if you are more or less able to eat, how you look and how you feel. You see here, the picture on the left, no girl paid attention to me, but here, the second picture, they did. I received an honorary bachelor's degree by Warner Pacific College in Portland. I was very humbled. And I told the audience, this was a commencement, there were about 1,000 people in the audience, that I had 2 dreams like being in camp. One dream was, a day should come that I should be able to eat as much bread as I want. Just bread. Not bread and butter. And to sleep on a mattress. To be free. Thank God this materialized and this bread comes to me. My other dream was to be reunited with my family, which unfortunately did not materialize. But I never dreamt that one day I'm going to be a free person in the United States and be honored by such a distinguished audience at Warner Pacific College. They all became PhDs, and I didn't finish elementary school. So Professor Barber, the president of the college, came to the podium, and that's what he said. Mr. Wiener, I promise you that we PhDs can learn more from your experience that you can learn from all of us. By the same token, I hope that you too will be able to learn from my experience. I received an honorary law degree from Lewis and Clark Law School because it happened, the dean read my book and he realized that my book can have a tremendous positive impact on those who read the book from an educational point of view. If you remember, I gave you 3 reasons why I'm making an effort to share my story. This is the feedback that I'm getting, that there are people who know nothing about the Holocaust, and the third reason, the people who are denying the Holocaust. What do you see in the picture? That is how it started. The Germans came to the houses and picked up the people, the elderly people, the very young, who didn't fit for work, and they sent them to killing centers. There are 6 killing centers in Poland. Auschwitz, Majdanek, Treblinka, Chelno, where the elderly and the very young were sent directly to be killed. My younger brother, at the age of 10, was taken on February 18, 1943, directly to Auschwitz. He didn't fit for work. And he was never there the same day or the following day. But that's how it happened. This picture was taken by a German soldier. This is not the case. How can people deny it happened? This is a very similar picture. This picture was taken by an American soldier. These are shoes taken away from those little kids before they are pushed into the gas chamber. Every day when I take a shower, I took it a shower head, and I talk to myself, what went through the mind of my little brother at the age of 10 that he was pushed into a gas chamber? He lived over there for 3 minutes, and then instead of water, Cyclone B gets choked into death. How much did that little boy suffer? And why? Who had a heart to murder a million and a half children under the age of 14 in such a brutal way? So people have the nerve to deny the Holocaust. General Eisenhower, the commander of the Allied forces in World War II, gave an order to the American general, take pictures of those liberated camps, because one day somebody might say it didn't happen. What did they find in those camps? You can see mounds and mounds of dead bodies. And those who are still walking were half dead. This is not the case. Unfortunately, he was correct. There are people who dare to say it did not happen. In the Nuremberg trials, this lasted from 11 months, from November 1945 to October 1946. Those 24 German officials and military commanders, when they were brought to justice to the International Tribunal, they didn't deny the Holocaust. All they did say for their defense was, we have to follow Hitler's orders. But they didn't deny them. So people have the nerve to say it didn't happen. In Babi Yar, in the Ukraine, this picture was taken by a German soldier. Hundreds of thousands of innocent people were forced to dig their own graves, and they were buried alive. There is now a priest in France by the name of Patrick Dubois that he dedicated his life to find mass graves in the Ukraine and Russia. And so far, he located 860 mass graves of those innocent victims. This picture was taken by a British soldier in Bergen, Belgium. That is what they found in those liberated camps. Mounds and mounds of dead bodies. This man in the middle is my schoolmate. We went together to school. This picture was taken by an American soldier. He died one day after the war. Thousands of Holocaust survivors died soon after the war because they couldn't digest the normal food given to them by the American, British, and the French. This is a picture. It is tragic by itself. That the American doctors didn't know that you cannot give a hamburger to somebody who had been deprived of basic nutrients for so long. This was written by a German clergyman a few months after the war. I would appreciate if you all read it together. Go ahead, please. Read it in uniform, I can hear you. Thank you. This is basically the same thing that I said to you before. If you see injustice, prejudice, speak up. Do something about it. Did the German exchange student that she kept interviewing me in this floor where I live, at the door she said, under Hitler, any baby that was born with a kind of disability or handicap was murdered by the doctors and the nurses. Hitler gave an order that he doesn't want any sick people. So any baby that was born in a hospital with a kind of a problem was murdered by the doctors and the nurses. The same doctor who, when they graduated medical school, they gave the Hippocratic oath that they are going to be compassionate, they became murderers under the Nazis. What you see here, I spoke in one school. At the end of my presentation, a student approached me and she said to me, I heard you, but I didn't see you. Initially, I didn't get it, what she meant, but apparently she is legally blind. So she couldn't see me, but she heard me. And when I mentioned that, what happened under Hitler, that she realized if she would be born in Germany with impaired vision, she would be murdered as an infant. So they decided to have a play in the school based on my story, and she is playing a role of an inmate in a camp. This is a book written by an author named Trudy Goodrich. It's going to come out next month. It's called The Gift from the Enemy. It's based about my story, about the German woman who gave me the sandwich. It's going to be an illustrated book. It's going to be a very good book, especially for young students between the age of 8 and 12. So this is basically very briefly my life story. I'll leave as much time as possible for you to ask questions. There are very, very few Holocaust survivors left. I'm one of the very few. I'm just so busy, I have no time to die. But before I finish my presentation, let me tell you something about hope, which is very, very important. In March 1945, I couldn't work anymore. I was so weak. So the Germans decided to kill me. That's the way the system works. If you cannot work, if you cannot be utilized, they kill you. But in that camp, there was no crematorium. So they sent me to a killing center. I was standing in line, I saw the chimney, I could smell the offensive odor of burning flesh. I was so scared. I knew that my life is coming to an end. While I was standing in line, a German entrepreneur approached me and he shouted at me, come and ask now, but you can't go by the Albert Kapir, get out of that line, young boy, you can still work. And he sent me back to work. And a few weeks later, I was free. You never know, never give up hope. And let me finish on a lighter note. The other day I went to a high school and a student asked me, how old are you? So I gave him my age. So he said, how come you live so long? You suffer so much? I don't know. God knows. All I can tell you, my lifestyle. I don't drink alcohol. I don't smoke. I don't take drugs. I'm a vegetarian. This might have something to do with my longevity. So he said, are you telling me that you have no vices? Vices? Okay, I have two vices. I like chocolate and woman. So he said, me too. The following year, I was invited to the same school, and the teacher, the female teacher, gave me a bar of chocolate. And she said to me, I remember from last year your two vices. I can satisfy you with one vice only. But if you come next year, we shall see. Always hope.
So at this time, we have a few minutes to do questions. So if you have a question, raise your hand. And either Waxman Felcher, myself, or Mrs. Miller will come get them from you.
I grew up in a very, very religious home. When I was taken to camp, they took away my prayer book. But I remembered most of the prayers by heart. I continued to pray in the camp, on the way to work, at work, from work. I never gave up my faith. I had questions. I couldn't understand. You know, the Pope Paul John II or Pope Benedict, when they went to visit Auschwitz, they asked God, how could you have kept silent? I had never given up my faith. Faith and hope go together. So when people ask me, what kept you going? So faith is one of the components. And I'm grateful to my parents the way they brought me up.
Question is, did you ever marry or have a family?
My wife is married. Yeah, I married many years ago. And actually, I married for 62 years. But my wife has been in an institution, in a nursing home for many years at Parkinson. I have two sons and six grandchildren. I cannot compete with my great-grandfather because he had 28 children and 252 grandchildren. You read my book.
Okay, I'm going to let Aaron ask the question. It was a little more complex.
Hi, Mr. Wiener. Thank you for coming. My question is, you've given a great example to us about how even the Germans, there are good Germans and bad Germans. In ninth grade, we've been reading books about the Holocaust, and we've been talking a lot about the companionship and camaraderie between prisoners, how sometimes block leaders would be cruel and condescending, yet there would still be examples of block leaders within camps that would be kind and caring towards their subordinates. Do you have any examples of that?
My eating is not so good, I'm sorry.
And if you do read my book, you'll see at one point a German guard threw me a brown bed with a piece of bread. By doing so, he risked his life. So, but my point is, if you remember, I mentioned before, every Jew was a victim, but not every victim was a Jew. But the same token I can say, every Nazi was a German, but not every gem was a Nazi. So obviously, there are still good people among the German people. The problem was that they all lived in fear. They were afraid to say anything or to act anything against Hitler's regime. Did I answer the question? Thank you.
Were there ever any riots? Riots.
No, we didn't rebel. There were a few, very few cases of rebellion, like in Sobibor. In all those five camps that I was there, incarcerated, nobody ever dared to do anything. Why? Very simple. It would be suicide. We had nothing to fight with. You know, the uniform that was given to me in Brandenburg had no pattern. No pattern. We owned nothing. No possession. The only possession that we had was the bowl for the soup and a spoon. Nothing else. Now to fight there, you need something to fight with. You need a weapon. Even to commit suicide was very difficult because we didn't have a knife, we didn't have rope. The only thing what you could do to die, stop eating altogether. But to fight that was impossible. And then, don't forget, there was a guard on each watchtower along the camp. We were very, very well guarded all the time. If you did see that movie, the boy that said pajama, let us know how it was. You could approach a certain gate of a camp and not be trapped. So this was very, very difficult, and all the five camps that I was incarcerated, there was no rebellion. That's the way it was. We had nothing to fight with. And then, remember, if one of us would have managed to escape, you know what would have happened? All the others would have been punished, collective punishment. This was the German system. If a German soldier was killed in a village, either in Germany or in Poland, you know what happened? The entire village was wiped out. So if you have a conscience, you don't try to do anything against the regime.